Following a decline of global slave trade in the mid-1800s, Europeans wanted to find the next big profitable thing. Their interest on Africa shot up following explorations that revealed rich resources which stirred their appetite in the midst of their industrial revolution. European nations, boosted by their superior military technology, were from here locked in a race for control of the largest possible territory in Africa, at the expense of the local kingdoms and empires. Tensions flared due to this intense competition, but in 1884, a conference was held in Berlin to find a way to regulate colonization and to partition the continent without having to go to war for it. Almost everyone got a slice, but one notable absence, Russia, did not get a single colony on the continent. So why didn't Russia take part in the scramble for Africa? Welcome to Reason Africa. Frequent viewers of the channel know I've talked quite a bit about Belgium's King Leopold's infamous rule over the entire Congo as his personal property. This colony, 80 times larger than the size of Belgium, ended up being the largest country in sub-Saharan Africa, admittedly. Compared with countries that have economies and populations of a similar size, Belgium has consistently punched above its weight in shaping international affairs. However, Russia, a major power center in the world, which has more experience as an expansionist imperialist, should have ended up with a sizable chunk of colonies in Africa. With its massive size, if Russia was to have the same ratio of colony to homeland, Russia would have to conquer an incredible number of 40 Africas to be in the same league as Belgium. But Belgium had one thing that Russia did not, and that is the right location. You see, Russia has no borders near Africa and had a series of roadblocks to reach warm waters to be able to get to the continent. Unlike Italy, the United Kingdom, or France, they simply had no direct means to access Africa. The countries which had success in colonizing Africa had to have two things. They had to be united, as a divided country would not do much, and they had to be strong enough to take advantage of their geographical proximity to Africa. The two major exceptions to this rule were the United Kingdom, who simply colonized everywhere regardless, and Germany, whose colonies had to be surrendered after they lost the Great War. In the case of Russia, while unity and military strength were not a problem, it is important to remember a couple of factors. One, the northern route was exceptionally long, and the port of Arkhangelsk was frozen for any seafaring vessels to cut through the ice sheets. Second, the Baltic Sea route meant that Russia had to pass Germany, Denmark, the United Kingdom, and France, all of whom had no incentive to let the Russians become a competitor in Africa. Therefore, it wouldn't have taken too much to render the Baltic Sea route a path of most resistance for the Russians. The third route was through the Danelle Strait, which could also have been blocked quite easily by the Ottomans, who were Russian sworn enemies. The two empires engaged in a series of 12 military conflicts, which were actually the longest conflict in European history, fought between the 16th and the 20th centuries. The Ottomans, therefore, would not do any favors for Russian expansion to Africa. The fourth route meant traveling around the entire continent of Asia, which would be too long and too expensive, seeing that Asia is the largest continent on the planet. Instead of expanding west, like the other European colonial powers of the time, the Russians decided to expand eastwards towards the Pacific Sea and colonized Siberia and as far as California. Russian colonial possessions in the Americas were collectively known as Russian America. Even though the Russians represented competition for high-demand colonies in Africa, the colonialist powers of the time still looked out for each other, and as a fellow colonial expansionist, the Russians were welcomed to the club at the Berlin Conference. But under strict conditions. They could not secure colonies in Africa. The purpose for their attendance was restricted to securing trade deals and to spread the Orthodox faith to Africa. By 1889, the scramble of Africa was over. Major European powers had carved out their colonies, but Russia still wanted to get a piece of the action. Russian adventurer Nikolai Ivanovich Ashinov came up with a bizarre plan to create a Russian territory in a small corner of the Horn of Africa, in what is today Djibouti. This culminated in a melodramatic fiasco, given that this territory had already been annexed by France. In January 1889, Ashinov launched an expedition to the area with two objectives: to find an African colony, which he promptly called New Moscow, and to establish relationships with the Ethiopian Coptic Church, and later to expand and colonize the rest of the Horn of Africa. Together with a group of about 2,000 Cossacks, Ashinov raised this flag in the village of Sagalo to symbolize the takeover. However, this newfound territory of New Moscow lasted less than a month. Ashinov and his expedition made the front cover of newspapers and generated a huge stir back in France. The French, who had been issued this territory at the Berlin Conference, put Russia to task to explain their activities in their sovereign land. The Russian government distanced themselves from Ashinov, who was immediately arrested and sent to Russia, where he was later exiled to Siberia. Whether Ashinov's actions were a covert mission sanctioned by the Russian government is anyone's guess. I was shocked during research to find out that Russia had actually attempted to colonize Madagascar well before the Berlin Conference took place. Despite some deep digging around, I could not find sufficient information on this, since the expedition by the Russians to Madagascar, led by Peter the Great, was top secret. The plan was, in the opinion of the Russian emperor, so strategically important that he ordered it to be carried out in the strictest secrecy. Even in the classified papers in Russia, the destination was not indicated. It was replaced by a very significant phrase: follow to your assigned place. Kindly share in the comments section below if you can find anything on this. Some sources, however, say the Russians did not manage to colonize this Indian Ocean island nation because they did not have adequate knowledge of the land and it was too expensive to run a colony this far from their homeland, demonstrated also by the Russians selling off Alaska to the United States. This could be unrelated, but perhaps this historical attachment to Madagascar could explain the alleged meddling of Russia in the last Madagascar general elections as part of a push by Russia to increase its influence in Africa. The presence of Russian political strategists with alleged ties to the Kremlin, posing as tourists with the alleged aim of helping to control the tightly fought race, raised questions about Russia's motives with Madagascar. Obviously, I'm not advocating for colonialism, but when you think about the colonial policies the colonizing nations had, for instance, France had direct rule with elements of assimilation policy. German and Belgian colonialism was particularly cruel, basically a cruel form of paternalism. Italy's colonial policy, on the other hand, from what I gather, had a preservation policy. Portugal's colonial policy had a mixture of direct rule, paternalism, and assimilation. Spain had some paternalistic elements. British rule was more of indirect rule. If Russia had been part of the scramble for Africa and carved out a portion of the continent for itself, what do you think the colonial policy would have been like? Today, Russian political aspirations in Africa include regaining the leverage once enjoyed by the Soviet Union by re-establishing presence as a non-colonial power. In 2019, the Russia-Africa Summit, the first of its kind, ended with the usual optics and photo ops, but also had $12.5 billion in business deals, largely in military equipment. That's a wrap, guys. A massive thank you to our growing list of patrons. Your generosity is profoundly appreciated. If you'd like to support us to keep producing quality content, kindly head over to patreon.com/reasonafrica. That's patreon.com/reasonafrica. As always, guys, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time.